Hi guys, welcome to the channel. This is the first of a three-part video series where we're going to build a new video editing and gaming workstation that we're going to call Project Linnaean Hydra. That machine behind me right there. In part one, we're going to run through what it is we're trying to achieve with this build and component selection. In part two, we'll actually build and verify the machine on a test bench. And then in part three, we're going to run some benchmarks and see if all our calculations really paid off. So to design our build, we'll be using the website pcpartpicker.com. This free-to-use site lets you build a parts list for your PC one component at a time. It compares the prices from several retailers and even gives you some guidelines around compatibility. For example, it'll tell you if your chosen CPU will fit the motherboard that you've already selected. So let's start off with the CPU. AMD lost the battle for the high end of the market several years ago, so we're only going to look at the Intel offerings. Now, most PCs don't need anything more than a 4-core processor, even for gaming, as the software just can't take advantage of the multiple threads. Video editing, and especially video encoding, certainly can, and the more CPU horsepower that you can throw at it, the better. So we're going to look at processors that have 6 or more cores. Let me just sort this list by price. And to avoid wading through ancient low clock speed Xeons, let's only look at stuff that runs at 3 GHz or faster. This shows us the Core i7-5820K is by far the cheapest option to give us 6 cores running at a nice 3.3 GHz. But it is significantly cheaper than the other 6 core offerings, and there's a good reason for that. It only has 28 PCIe lanes, whereas its bigger brother, the 5930K, has 40, but you do pay another $200 for that privilege. Why would you care about the number of lanes? Each expansion card you add to your system requires a certain number of lanes in order to communicate with the CPU at full speed. Graphics cards consume 16 lanes. So if you want to run 2 graphics cards at full speed, you can't. If you're only planning on running 1 graphics card, you may be thinking that you don't need to worry about any of this, but it's not quite that simple. If you're planning on using a PCIe SSD drive, that's another 4 lanes gone. A dual 10 gig Ethernet adapter? There goes another 4 lanes. What about a dual Thunderbolt 2 card for your storage array? That'll be another 4 lanes, please. You kind of get the idea. Right now, 28 lanes would suffice for my needs, even with the storage and connectivity that I'm planning to use, but I may want to add a second graphics card in the future, so I'm going to stick with a 40-lane processor for now. Now, it's worth one word on the Xeon processors that you may come across. These are server or indeed workstation processors, but they offer no benefit to most users other than the ability to use ECC RAM, which is expensive, and also requires a more expensive motherboard. Yes, Xeons allow you to use 2 physical chips if you have the money, but there are some serious diminishing returns to that approach, so unless you know for a fact that you can take advantage of more than 10 or 12 cores, I advise you to save a truckload of money and stick with a single processor. If you're earning a living from your machine and you're so busy that downtime or failed renders actually cost you money, ECC memory can be worthwhile as the system can warn you of failing memory chips so you can replace them during some downtime, but in the meantime the system will continue to run. To get a jump in performance over and above the 5930K, we need to make a huge jump from $560 to basically $1,000. This buys us an older generation but highly overclockable 4960X, which will run reliably at a much higher speed than the advertised 3.6 GHz, and it's great for gaming. But at this price point, we find something interesting. For just another $6, we can have an 8-core processor, the 5960X. It's advertised as running at a comparatively lowly 3 GHz. But the X at the end of the model number means it's also an extreme edition processor, and that will also overclock very well, just like the 4960X. Now, $1,000 may seem a lot of money, because it is. But before this particular chip came along, to get an 8-core processor meant coughing up at least $2,000 for a Xeon, and that again meant buying that more expensive motherboard and memory. If I wanted to save $500 on this build, I'd go with the 5930K, and I'd be very happy with it. But I'm going to spend the extra and I'm going to pull the trigger on the 8-core. So let's choose our motherboard next. The site has already filtered the boards to show only those that have an LGA 2011-3 socket that's needed by our processor. I like Asus boards. I've used them in the past, I've been very happy with them, and they have a good reputation for reliability and well-thought-out feature sets. Now, I will want an M.2 socket because I do plan on using an M.2 form factor SSD drive, although unfortunately the site doesn't let me drill down and filter to only show the M.2 sockets that bypass SATA and run at PCIe x4 speed, but we can figure that out for ourselves. I'll also want a pair of gigabit Ethernet ports so I can bond them together to get 2 gigabits of bandwidth to my NAS, which is also 2 gigabit capable. So this leaves us with a few choices. The cheapest, the X99MWS, is a physically smaller micro ATX board that sacrifices a few things to shrink itself down. We only get 4 memory slots, and having already checked, I know the M2 slot doesn't support the full PCIe x4 speed. Our next option is the X99 Sabertooth, which has 8 memory slots and comes in a rather cool and military looking black and grey finish, which I rather like, as brightly painted parts aren't really my thing. So let's quickly check the Asus website to get the specs on this board. So right up front, they're talking about connectivity and NVMe Express storage, which are the kind of features that we're looking for. It's also worth noting that the reason the board looks the way it does is because it's part of what they call their TUF range, which stands for the Ultimate Force, which I guess is their way to make it sound more military. So let's scroll down here and see what this means for reliability and stuff. They talk about airflow, reliability, high-end component selection, and more importantly, they back it up with a 5-year warranty, so they obviously have some faith in their product. On top of that, the board is tested by an independent third party to ensure it meets military standards. Now, it's worth noting that most of these military specs are pretty much irrelevant to the average user. Will you really be subjecting the inside of your desktop PC to corrosive salt spray? I certainly won't. But at the end of the day, the fact it passes these tests is certainly not a bad thing. I do like to see the word server grade mentioned, although it doesn't really carry any real legal or technical meaning. But as servers are generally meant to run under load for 24/7, hopefully it's a good sign of how the engineers were thinking when they designed the thing. So then they run through all the overclocking features, like extra power supply pins to the chip for better stability and all the ports. But what I want to point out is a feature they've buried way down near the bottom of the page, and that's the PCIe x4 storage. Now, they use gigabits to talk about transfer speeds, as they should, but SSD drive manufacturers seem to like stamping megabyte figures on their drives for some reason. So let's quickly talk about that. A typical SATA SSD drive claims to offer read and write speeds around the 500 megabyte per second mark. 500 megabytes is half a gigabyte. To convert from bytes to bits, you multiply by 8. So a half a gigabyte per second is 4 gigabits per second. So by the time you add in some overhead, a single SSD drive will saturate your 6 gigabit SATA controller. This is why the SSD drives you see on the market for the last 3 or 4 years all top out at around about 550 megs a second. They can't go any faster because the interface is a bottleneck. Well, over the last year or so, a few manufacturers have started shipping PCIe SSD drives as opposed to SATA drives. These plug into a spare PCIe slot on your motherboard and bypass the SATA controller completely. The first ones run at PCIe x2 speeds and offered over 1 gigabyte per second transfer speeds, just over double the performance of their SATA versions. And now there's PCIe x4 versions, which are twice as fast again and can throw data around at well over 2 gigabytes per second. As they're PCI cards, they're pretty bulky, but if you're to open one up, you'll find something not much larger than a stick of gum, certainly way smaller than the 2.5-inch hard drives that we all used to think were small. The reason for this is laptop manufacturers like Apple, who wanted to shrink the size of their products and realised that there was no reason to stuff a couple of flash chips inside a comparatively cavernous 2.5-inch hard drive casing just for backwards compatibility purposes. So they were one of the first to use the stick of gum style M2 slot for their drives. The first ones were still hooked up to the SATA controller, so there was no speed benefit, but the latest M2 slots bypass that and hook straight into the PCIe bus. So now you need to be very careful choosing your motherboard if you want to use an M2 form factor drive. If it's a SATA interface M2 drive, the slot on the board must be a SATA M2 slot. If it's a PCIe x2 drive, then you need at least a PCIe x2 M2 slot. And most importantly, if you're buying the very latest PCIe x4 M2 drive, the M2 slot on your board also needs to be PCIe x4 if you actually want to use the drive at its full speed. And obviously you do, otherwise you wouldn't have paid the premium to buy one in the first place. I intend to use a PCIe x4 M2 drive, so it's good to see that the Gen 3 x4 is being clearly listed here, as is the ability to use M2 drives of several lengths, with 80mm being the most common in case you were wondering. The drive I'm going to use claims a 2.2 gigabyte per second transfer speed, so multiplying it by 8 to get bits we get 17.6, which is way over the gigabits the earlier PCIe x2 slot would have managed, so we would have been seriously bottlenecked, whereas the 32 gigabits of bandwidth offered by the x4 interface is not going to cause us any problems whatsoever. I do like all these dust covers that Asus provide with the board, not just for the external ports, but also for any unused internal slots. So let's add this to the parts list. So the site is now warning me that I have a compatibility issue in my choices so far, but if I were to click on the details link, it would just tell me that I don't have a CPU cooler. The Extreme Series chips from Intel don't ship with a cooler, unlike their lower tier processors, because Intel know full well that enthusiasts don't use stock coolers, especially on processors that they're going to overclock, with Intel's blessing, I might add. So we can ignore that warning for now. So let's add some memory. The site helpfully filters out anything that isn't DDR4, as that's what our config needs. Ultimately, I want to be able to put 64GB in this rig, but I'm going to start out with 32. Now, I could do all this on a 4-slot board, but in order to wring the last drop of performance out of the processor, I want to use quad-channel mode, which means I need to install memory in batches of 4 sticks. So I'll buy 4 8GB sticks now and get full speed, and then add another 4 8GB sticks later for more capacity, while still getting the maximum bandwidth out of the memory subsystem. They offer memory sticks in all sorts of colours these days, so I'm going to filter this just to show me the black ones. Now, at this point, the majority of enthusiasts would spend a lot of money buying the highest clock speed rating they could get their hands on. And as you go from DDR4 2133 up 2400, 2600, 2800 to even 3000 or more, the prices really start to climb. But nothing in tech is ever that simple, and when you're choosing RAM, you should take a look at the latency speed as well, which is the CAS column here. Typically speaking, the faster the clock speed of the RAM, the higher the bandwidth, but the higher the latency figure as well, and a higher latency means a longer delay before data starts flowing. There are several videos on YouTube that benchmark different RAM speeds and whether you go for higher clock speed with higher latency or lower clock speed with lower latency, the overall memory performance stays roughly the same, to at least within like 2%. Basically unnoticeable to you as a user, and given the price premium for higher bandwidth sticks, because they can cost twice as much as lower clock stuff, in my opinion, it's a very poor value way to spend your money. So looking at this list, I'm going to go with the 2400 version of the Corsair Vengeance LPX RAM, as for $210, I get a 2400 clock with a 14 CAS figure. Now to better that, I would need to buy the Kingston 2400 sticks with a nice CAS of 12, but they're an extra $80, which is, what, 40% more or something? No thanks. So now I'll add in the storage, the boot drive to be specific. I like Samsung for my SSDs, as they're a tier 1 flash memory chip manufacturer. The drives are well respected for reliability, and they give great performance numbers. And they're one of the first out of the block with the PCIe x4 M.2 stick. And here it is, the SM951. It's an M.2 2280, which means it's M.2 form factor, 22mm wide, which I believe all M.2 drives are, and 80mm long, which we know will fit in our motherboard. The largest capacity they offer at the moment is 512GB, so I'm going to grab one of those. Now for the case. This is very much a personal choice, as styling is entirely subjective. I don't want anything in bright, glossy colours. I want a plain front as opposed to some fancy moulding. And to that end, I have no need for optical drives and whatnot. So with that in mind, I want to get a smaller case, as I won't be using an extended ATX size board, nor will I be running quad GPU cards or multiple 3.5-inch hard drives. I was going to go with a white case until I saw a nice matte black one from NZXT, the H440, that had been styled by Razer, even though it was a bit larger than I needed. But a couple of days later, they announced another matte black model, again by Razer, that was actually a lot smaller. In particular, it was narrower, and that's great as my desk space is rather limited, and I don't like putting machines on the floor where they pull in more dust, filters or otherwise. This S340-based case is also a little cheaper at $99, and that's a right result. The green lighting is also quite tastefully done as far as case lighting goes, and the side panel window is actually tinted, which will give a slightly more subtle look into the innards of the beast. The front also hides a huge filtered opening for drawing in fresh air, and can accommodate a 280mm radiator with a pair of 140mm fans, which is going to be ideal for keeping the temperature of the heavily overclocked 8-core processor under control. The maximum board size it'll take is a standard ATX, which is handy, as that's what I'll be using, and that's one of the things that helps keep the size of the case down. Having been primarily a Mac user for 12 years, or more actually, I've come to appreciate attention to detail, and the fact that the Razer not only matched the power and drive activity lighting to the other lights on the case, but even spent a considerable sum of money having green USB 3 ports made instead of the off-the-shelf blue, really appeals to me. So it's a mere 7.87 inches wide, and has 2.5 inch SSD drive bays, which would be useful for my data drives, so I'm going to add this to the parts list. Now we've confirmed the case we'll be using, we can pick our CPU cooler and get rid of that warning message. In their press release, NZXT specifically stated that the case was designed to take their biggest all-in-one CPU cooler, the 280mm Kraken X61. So rather than use someone else's 280mm cooler and potentially have issues with rad thickness and who knows what else, let's go with their Kraken, as there's nothing wrong with it, and the pump unit on top of the processor, which they're showing here as lighting up in blue, can actually be configured to glow green through their software so everything will match. Now, I did add my SSD boot drive, but I also need some storage for my data files, so I'm going to add some more SSDs. I don't need a lot of space, 1 terabyte is enough, as the bulk of my stuff is stored on my NAS, but for video files that I'm actively working on, they need to be kept locally for speed reasons, and once I'm finished with them, they'll be moved off to the NAS for archiving. Now, I could add a single 1 terabyte drive in here, but remember what I said earlier about SATA drives topping out at around 550 megabytes a second? To get more speed, we're going to use 4 of the discrete SATA 6GB ports on our X99 board to run 4 250GB SSD drives together in RAID 0 via the motherboard BIOS, and that'll give us our 1 terabyte. Performance-wise, this scales up pretty well, so we can expect to see 4 times 550MB or over 2GB per second of performance off this kind of setup, versus the 550MB performance of a single 1TB drive. Again, I'm sticking with Samsung, and I already have a pair of 250GB EVO 950s lying around from a previous project, so I'm going to buy 2 more here to give me my 4 in total. Okay, now for the graphics card. A couple of months ago, Nvidia released the GeForce GTX 980 Ti, which offered as near as makes no difference identical performance to their top-of-the-line Titan X card, but was a third cheaper. When it comes to graphics cards, especially high-end models, there are typically 2 types offered. The reference versions, designed entirely by the GPU manufacturer, in this case Nvidia, and various overclocked versions, which the companies who are actually licensed to build these things will design later, to improve performance through overclocking, which requires better cooling designs, and they can be sold at a much higher profit margin. I don't need to squeeze the last ounce of performance out of this card. If I really need more, I'll just add a second one in an SLI configuration and get a major boost in horsepower, and I especially don't want a bit more performance at the expense of noise, heat, or stability. Reference design cards use turbine-style blowers which take air in from the case and blow it out of the back of the graphics card. This helps stop a hard-working GPU from heating up everything else in your case. As I'm more concerned with the temperature of my CPU, motherboard and drives than I am the performance of the graphics card, and I don't want to fit more case fans to deal with it, I'll be going with a reference design. Incidentally, all reference design cards are identical. It doesn't matter which brand you buy, so just get the cheapest one. Okay, we're nearly there. The last item is the power supply unit. PC Part Picker does keep track of the power consumption of the parts you choose, and in this case it's telling me that I could pull as much as 513 watts at peak. I may want to run a second 980 Ti in future, so I'm going to allow for that now, and I know these cards max out at around 250 watts, so I'll need at least a 760 watt unit. In fact, due to overclocking, a couple of extra SSDs and some more memory sticks or networking cards, I'm going to allow myself another 100 watts on top of that, so I'll filter my search to show me units that are 850 watts or more. I'll also want a fully modular unit, which means all the power cables are separate instead of being hardwired into the unit itself, so I won't need all of them, and rather than trying to stuff them into some corner of the case, I can just use the ones I need, which is much easier to deal with. So sorting the list by price, I'll point out that I'm a fan of Corsair units, as I've found them to be very reliable in the past, and here I can see 3 of their units that are not crazy expensive. Corsair has several ranges, with some offering software monitoring, better quality fan bearings, and so on. The RM range is one of their cheapest ranges, but my eye is immediately drawn to the HX850i. The HX range are more power efficient than the RM range, but you can see here that it's platinum rated versus gold. In addition, they have a 0 RPM fan mode for when they're not being pushed hard, which will be most of the time, which helps keep the rig quiet, and the I designation means Corsair iLink, which is software monitoring. So I'll choose the HX850i over the RM1000, because the only thing that has to offer in its favour is a higher power rating of 1000 watts, which I don't actually need. Actually, it is worth pointing out that buying a much larger power supply than you'll ever need is not a good idea, as you typically need to run the PSU at 50 to 70% of its peak rating in order for it to be at its most power efficient. If I run a 1000 watt unit with a single graphics card, or maybe even 2, it won't be in that 50% plus range most of the time, and that's just wasting electricity. Okay, I will be buying some peripherals, but they're a very personal choice, so I'm not going to cover them in this video. I also already have a large monitor, so we're basically done here. My target was $3,000, and $3,045 is close enough. So I'm going to get all this stuff ordered up while you hopefully hit that like button and subscribe so you can follow the build in part 2, where I'll assemble all the parts on the test bench to verify everything works before building it for real in part 3.